Nothing much.
So hi, hello, my name is Esther, is that, that's also what you can call me. I work in this organization called the YP Foundation. We work with young people on a variety of different issues. A lot of what we do is based on gender and sexuality and working with young people to give them greater access to information and to services related to reproduction and everything connected to that. We also do things on health and education. Primarily all of our work is dedicated to working with making young people more informed citizens and helping them to know more about themselves and things that they should know about as they get older. I didn't actually realize that you guys have already started doing your research projects. I have kind of a really specific thing that I wanted to talk to you guys about. Is that okay, or would you prefer that we just kind of like talk about a bunch of different things that's relevant to your project?
Yeah. Of course, they're going to give you both answers. Would you like to hear some of the topics that they're doing?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah? Okay, so how about a few people raising? So let's start with you, Lola.
I'm doing criminalization of gay identity.
Okay. Yeah?
I'm doing child labor.
Okay.
Human trafficking.
Okay.
Child trafficking and how that results in forced begging.
Okay.
Menstruation and especially how it affects women in rural India.
Okay.
Sexual harassment.
Gender inequality, how it affects women in India.
Okay.
Women's empowerment through education.
Okay, cool. So, I mean, I suppose what I really want to talk to you about kind of ties up a little bit of everybody's papers, maybe, kind of, sort of. I think maybe I'll just like kind of work with something that's, you know, I think gender and inequality is kind of an open, allows you to talk about many, many different things. You also said education, somebody else said infanticide, trafficking, you said menstruation, and yeah, okay. Different things. I was thinking that I would talk to you about young people who have worked on all of these different issues in India and people who have started movements around different things in India. Let's see like if you can kind of connect that to the different things that you're working on. I'm not so sure trafficking really comes into that, but trafficking is also a fairly like large issue, and I'm like open to take questions if you have any, and then I could see if I could answer those if that works for you guys. Where do I start even? What do you guys know about what has been going on in America recently? Like, do you have any knowledge about what's been happening there?
We do.
Miss
my class.
Trump.
Okay. Is that a board
model? Yep. There's that green. I'm imagining you might be talking about some of the LGBT rights or things like that.
Yeah, too. Sure. Like anything.
Yeah.
Anything.
What do we
know? Like talking about?
Transgender people aren't allowed into the bathrooms that they identify with. They're only allowed in the bathrooms that they were born in.
Okay.
Chose the woman's mark.
Okay. What do you know about the Women's March?
A lot of it was based around how it was around the time that Trump was inaugurated as president, so it was kind of rebelling, talking about how he said some horrible things about women, mm-hmm. and how he's a sexist and racist.
Okay. Can we add to the list? There's also, you know, been a lot of talk about Star Wars and about how there are lots more female characters in Star Wars and a lot of the main characters are women. So, let's say women in media. The Women's March was also connected to abortion rights and how, you know, the new government is going to kind of crack down on this and make it harder to access this right. Yeah? Okay, cool. So, like, these are some 5, 3, 4, 5, 6 issues in America. What do you know about issues in India? I mean, you are working on it, so yeah?
You're not allowed to know the gender of your baby before.
Okay. Okay. What else?
It's illegal to have gay sex.
Okay.
At certain places, women aren't allowed to do stuff when, while they're menstruating. For example, going into a temple or a bathroom or stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I suppose what we could say maybe that there are really very different issues in America and other developing places and more developed places and places like India. Is that like fair to assume from what we've seen with these two lists? Okay, cool. So yeah. What I was thinking I would talk to you about is about how there are some weird and interesting, you know, parallels and mirror images that are happening in countries like USA and countries like India, and about how there are lots of like similar things happening in these two places, particularly when we look at university campuses and people who are, you know, not a whole lot older than you, who are, you know, standing up and saying, this is not okay, I would like to say something about this. So, hold on, let me just take my notebook out too. My notes. So have you guys heard about the slut walks? No? No? Okay. So there was this, I think it started in Canada. There was this cop who came to a college to speak to the students over there about safety. And he, you know, while he was talking to women about self-defense and about the need to be safe in the nighttime, he told them, women should avoid dressing like sluts in order to, you know, ensure that they don't get hurt. And a lot of the students stood up and said, well, that's not really a solution to the problem. And they started this march where they went out on the streets and said, we're happy to wear, it's not our clothes that causes the problem, it's people who are inflicting the violence that's causing the problem. I'm not asking to be raped when I wear the clothes that I wear. So a whole bunch of women went out on the streets in the most provocative clothes they could think of, you know, fishnet stockings, really short shorts, almost nothing, with slogans on them saying things like that. And that then took off, and now it's an annual thing that happens in Canada. It's also taken over the entire world. It went from Canada to USA to India, to Pakistan, to Europe, and also places in Central Asia, which I can't remember now, but it did in fact go there. We did have a similar thing in India, which, well, we tried to call it the slut walk, but it didn't really work for people in India, because slut is not a word that means a lot unless you know English. So they called it the Besharmi Morcha, which means the walk of the shameless. So that happened in 2009. We also had, you know, we had a bunch of different things, and primarily the thing about the slut walk was that they were saying that it's not really us that has to start policing ourselves and saying that we should dress differently, we shouldn't be out in the night time, we shouldn't be traveling at dark, in the dark. It should be other people who should stop doing violent things to women. And so a lot of what they were talking about was the... right to move freely and to be going places, going wherever they feel like without fear of violence being inflicted on them. We now have similar things showing up all over India apart from the slut walk. Have you guys been looking at the news lately in India? Have you heard about this thing called Pinjra Tod? Which is this thing called, it's two Hindi words. Pinjra Tod means break the cages. It's a group of girls in university who've decided, you know, we're going to fight back against university regulations that say women need to be locked in their hostels after a certain point, and that are saying, you know, women shouldn't be locked into hostels. We need to make the university a safer place for women. Yeah? Yes? Is everybody following? Okay, cool.
How do you spell?
I'll write it here for you. Pinjra Tod, which means break the cages. You know, then we've also had on New Year's Eve this year, there, you know how everybody goes out on New Year's Eve and they party, and usually it's a big party that happens on the street and things like that. In Bangalore, there was this mass molestation case where a bunch of women who were on the street were, you know, groped by other people who were around them. Spontaneously, it just happened, and you know, it turned into a big issue. Everybody called it the mass molestation on New Year's Eve. It was all over the news, and again, it turned into a nationwide movement where women went out on the streets saying, "I will go out because it's not my fault that I was out on New Year's Eve. It was their fault that they inflicted violence on me and that they touched me when I didn't ask to be touched." So that's another thing that's happened in the country called "I will go out." There are similar things that happen in the US called Take Back the Night. Which actually has a really long history. It started in 1970 or so when a woman who was coming back home from university was stabbed to death by, you know, somebody, and nobody came out and helped her. And ever since then, it's turned into, again, another annual thing. Everybody does it. They pick a day in the year and they just stay out all night. So that's like similar things that are happening in these two on the issue of freedom of mobility. Another thing that's been happening is, you know, every time there's an issue that shows up on the internet about a woman who has been criticized, Or for saying, you know, oh, men do these things, men rape women, it's all men's fault. There's that hashtag that comes up, not all men. Have you guys heard about that hashtag? Yeah, it's turned into a thing where every time people say, oh, you know, men really need to stop inflicting violence on women, men need to stop eve teasing women, men need to stop catcalling, everybody says, well, it's not all men that do it, it's only some men that do it. I'm a man that doesn't do it. There was a response to that in the US called Yes, All Women, which is where women just kept posting stories of how they were harassed on the streets, about how, you know, people annoyed them when they were outside, when they were at clubs, when they were at bars, when they were out with their friends, saying, I have enough stories about things that were inflicted on me for, you know, negative things that have happened to me, for me to say that this is something that affects all women. So that was something that happened. I was just calling Yes, All Women. Again, the similar thing that we had in India, one was a slut walk, a second was Pinjra Tod. We had another movement that also happened here, which was in Calcutta, which was about, you know, which, I mean, is a Bengali word called Hokuloro, which means raise your voices. Just people who came out on the street saying, when sexual harassment happens to a woman, it's not the woman's fault, and the administration and people around her need to take care of the person who was hurt rather than protecting the person who did the hurting. Yeah, so the issue of slut shaming and victim blaming is something that everybody talks about. Do these words make sense to you guys? Yeah? Is this something that you understand? Like, slut shaming means when you basically say it's the woman was asking for it because, you know, she's somebody who anyway was interested in having sex with somebody, and then when she was hurt, it was her fault because she put herself in that position. Victim blaming is when you say, you know, why were you out at this point? You shouldn't have gone out. It's a dangerous area. Or, you know, you shouldn't have been in that place at that time. Or you shouldn't have been wearing the clothes that you were wearing at that point. There's also, you know, I don't know if you guys have been looking at, like, Jennifer Lawrence and other people who, in Hollywood, who have said, you know, it's my choice if I have the body that I have, if I dress the way that I dress, if I talk the way that I talk, it's nobody else has the right to kind of comment on me, right? The question of choice and saying that I have the right to pick what kind of job I want, I have the right to pick what kind of partner I want to have, I have the right to decide what kind of body I want, and I don't always need to have the perfect body like, you know, everybody tells us we need to have. We had Deepika Padukone, who is a Bollywood star, who did a similar kind of campaign on my choice and the right to kind of, the freedom of choice to do all of the, whatever you feel like doing in all of these matters. Also, on the case of menstrual taboos, there was a case where, you know, a person in a temple said women can't come into the temple because when they're menstruating, they can only come in when they're not menstruating, and or actually women shouldn't be allowed to come in at all because we don't know when they're menstruating, and until we develop an x-ray machine that allows you to tell when a woman is menstruating and when she's not, we're not going to allow women into the temple. And a girl on the internet said, I don't think that whether I'm menstruating or not is a measure by which you can say whether I should come in or not, and I'm happy to bleed. And it turned into this campaign where everybody rallied around hashtag happy to bleed, which is like India based. If you look it up, you'll find it immediately. However, there was a similar thing that happened in Europe, and also, I don't know if you guys have heard about Rupi Kaur. She's a girl who is an Instagram artist. I mean, she's an artist and she was on Instagram, and she posted this series of pictures of her body when she was menstruating, and pictures of the, you know, the stains of blood, the blood on the floor and things like that, and Instagram kept taking it off saying this violates our policies. And then that turned into another huge thing where everybody was saying it's just blood, it's a normal thing, people should be allowed to post, you know, things about their natural bodily function. And it still hasn't been resolved. There's still lots of people saying, well, if you're allowed to post that, can I post all of the other things that I'm excreting from my body as well? Isn't that offensive? But she has now, her pictures have now turned into a campaign against menstrual taboos and about how women are always expected to kind of hide the fact that they're menstruating and to feel shame about, you know, any kind of evidence of their having ever menstruated ever in life. So yeah, menstrual taboos is something that you see across the world. And we had another thing called Pads Against Sexism, which came up in Europe, where a lady would just, you know, post pads all over, just on city lights, on lamps, on just across the street, with messages on it saying, you know, that women are being silenced. Just comments about how women are expected to, you know, women are put in these little boxes that they're supposed to fit into, and how that's kind of confining them. Basically, and she kept putting up these images and she kept writing them on pads, and people kept putting those pads down saying you can't have pads up everywhere, that's inappropriate and that's gross. And then it became a question of both talking about menstrual taboos and saying, you know, why are sanitary napkins gross even when they aren't used, and why am I not allowed to say the things that I'm saying about the patriarchy. You know, there's also a lot of moral policing that happens in India. I don't know if you guys have noticed this. A lot of people who are told not to hold hands, people who are too shy to kind of express any sort of affection for each other on the street. There was another movement about that called the Kiss of Love that came up, where people said, I don't care if you think that I shouldn't be allowed to do this, or if culture says that I shouldn't be allowed to do this, I'm going to kiss my partner because there isn't a law that says I shouldn't. That, I mean, got a lot of, it turned into a really, really big issue. A lot of people were talking about it and it never really got resolved. But we have a similar case of moral policing in the US, where young girls in schools were told, hey, maybe you should change your top because I think that your spaghetti top, you know, your tank top and things like that are distracting the boys from their studies. So you should go home and change. And that turned into a campaign in the US called My Body, My Business, started by the girl who, you know, was told to go home, where they talked about, just how you shouldn't be policed morally. So that was all that I really wanted to talk to you guys about. If you have any questions, you want to talk to me about other things, feel free to change the topic of conversation. Or tell me what you like to think like, or what you'd like to know more about.
How does this all kind of tie in with trans rights in India?
So, a lot of what I was talking about really was women's rights and women's empowerment. Trans rights in India is actually a fairly complex issue, because we do have, trans people being a part of the Indian sort of ecosystem in some ways. And if you go back in history, they've always been, part of the administrative system, where, in Mughal times, for instance, trans people were the people who were the sort of the guards of the women's area of a palace, because they were, the in-between. So this area would be female, that area would be male, and in-between is everybody who is neither here nor there. After which, they've kind of been marginalized in history, so they've become people who are sort of pushed out and seen as not really legitimate citizens. And so we also have the Hijra community, which again has developed its own sort of society and ecosystem across India. One part of it is that because they are communities who aren't given legitimacy, in that they aren't given jobs. They usually, when they ask for housing, they don't get given housing, because people don't want hijras living in their houses, because what would people say? And if they don't get jobs, they don't have money to get their own houses, and consequently, that means that they're reduced to a point where they're homeless and they don't have a job, which means that they're also perhaps on the street begging, and that then means that they become a community that focuses specifically on that act. They continue to be not really treated, as equal citizens of India, but they are being recognized more and more as a legitimate community. So the trans identity or the transgender identity is being recognized more and more. So a couple of years ago, universities were now told, there's a mandate that's been made across the country that says that trans has to be included as a gender identity when you're filling in government forms, particularly in universities and things like that. So you can say male, female, or trans. I don't know a whole lot about trans issues, but I can tell you that perhaps that's one way to look at it. You can look at it in terms of like legality. You could also look at it in terms of, how are people who are from that community creating their own society that's separate from everybody else that kind of doesn't want to see them, where they do have, people they can talk to, people they can identify with, people who recognize them as equals.
So how does, sexism between, women sort of relate to, gay identity? Because we already know that sexism in India is such a huge problem, and then bringing in gay identity helps. So, I'll try.
Okay. So, perhaps you should also think about, how sexism is to do specifically with gender, and people saying that the gender of woman, or not man really, including trans, is not treated as equal. And being gay is a sexual orientation, which is different.
Yeah.
So I mean, I suppose that like, it's a really broad question. I'm not really sure how you could answer that. You'd have to think about maybe specific issues or instances that you would like to talk about, and then work around that to kind of work out how are these two things different issues, but how are they connected to each other in this particular case. Yeah. I'm not really sure how you might answer that question. But you might, like, if you think of specific instances, perhaps I can help you work it out in that context. Yeah.
What do you think
female I mean, I'm not really, it's not a thing that people should do. I think it's wrong. I mean, what can I tell you about female infanticide?
Basically, what's
I mean, it is wrong to have women or to have girls being, you know, aborted or being killed and saying we don't, and yeah, and having sex selection, basically. But, I mean, one also has to think about what is the context in which something like female feticide occurs and who are the people who commit female feticide, right? So, one question is, one part of it is, yes, women are, you know, unequal and are not, you know, the people don't want to have female children. Another part of it is that a lot of people who don't want to have female children cannot afford to have female children, which means that so they would be happy to have a child, but they would like to have a child that could, one, contribute to the household monetarily as the child grows up, who can contribute to the you know, the physical labor that takes place in the household or outside the household. So if you're working on a farm, for example, you need to have somebody who can, you know, do farm work with you. And women are, by and large, because, you know, depending on what your kind of context is, women are not allowed to go out of the house beyond a certain point. So after you reach puberty, after you start menstruating, you are less likely to be allowed out of the house. And because, you know, there are so many social norms around, you need to marry early. In some, you know, and particularly in a lot of contexts, you do want to marry your children off early. People, when you marry off your daughter, you're expected to pay a dowry, which again, you're not supposed to do, but you know, the context kind of makes you do it. Like, I mean, it's an unwritten rule that people do it a lot of the time. So that means that you don't have the money to pay for that as well. So it's like a lot of different layers that come into it that kind of make the situation where people say having a female child is not feasible monetarily, even while people may actually want to have you know, female children. In a lot of cases, it's also, you know, who is the person who's making the decision about female feticide? Very rarely is it actually the mother who's saying, I don't want to have a female daughter. It's mothers who are, it's people around them who are saying, we would much rather have a male child rather than a female daughter.
There was an incident I read about where not the mother, but the mother's mother-in-law mm-hmm. forced the mother of the child to poison.
Yeah.
And the woman said, I didn't want to do it, but if I had, she would have kicked me out of the home.
Exactly.
Because
yeah.
They inherited that home. And
yeah.
The mother-in-law thought, like, she owned the home now.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's another big part of it, that a lot of women who are aborting their female children are saying, if I don't produce a male child, I will not be treated well in my household, and the existing children that I have will not be taken care of. So what will happen to them? What will happen to me? So there are like a lot of different layers that come into it. One is the money and what is your economic standing. One is you as an individual in the household, you have to figure out, as a mother, you have to figure out, like, how do I ensure that I'm available for my children to keep them safe? How do I keep myself safe? And that kind of makes the issue a very complicated one. Yeah. Yes.
Do you think you can define sexual harassment as, like, just staring at someone? Or, like, because sometimes when you, like, walk on the streets, you can see guys who are, like, and then you walk and you're, like...
Yeah. I mean, it really is dependent on how, you know, you think about it. A lot of people feel differently about this, and it depends on what kind of context you come from. So... Some people might call it sexual harassment. I would call it sexual harassment. A lot of people wouldn't call it sexual harassment. I would just say, you know, they're just, it's fine. They're not actually doing anything to me. They haven't said anything to me. They haven't touched me in any way. So why is it a problem? Like, why should I be allowed to tell somebody what they should or shouldn't look at? What they should or shouldn't say, as long as I can't hear what they're saying. Right? Does that make sense to you? Whereas other people will say, you don't need to actually be touching me. You don't need to be saying anything to me. But if I can feel your gaze on me, that is making me feel uncomfortable, and that's enough for it to be harassment. So, you know, it's not... I mean, there is a law about it now that they're trying to enforce in India that says you can't look at a woman for longer than 15 seconds or 10 seconds. I think that's what the law is. And it's turned into this bizarre situation where people are actually discussing this, where, you know, the problems are not really reduced to people staring at you. It's all of the other things that make people stare at you, right? Like, why do men stare at women on the road? A lot of it is because you're genuinely, it's a question of, there aren't a lot of women on the road, particularly at given points of the time, like given points of the night. So after dark, you see less women on the road, so people are more sort of, people are going to stare more at you if you're a woman on the road. If you're not from India, then people will stare at you more if you're in an Indian context, because you're not, I mean, you're exotic to them. You're not something that they see a lot. If you are, you know, depending on what part of India you're in, if you're in South India where a lot of people look like me, and a lot less people look, you know, really fair, you're more likely to get noticed. If you're in North India and you are very fair, a lot more people are going to look at me and say, well, this is new. I've not seen this before. And, you know, because otherwise, as, you know, as you grow up as a boy, you're kind of given all of the things that you want. A lot of your desires are fulfilled because boys are treated better than girls. You automatically feel like it's okay for you to stare. Whereas a woman will not perhaps feel like it's as okay to stare, even if she thinks that you are as exotic, you know, even if she thinks that you are interesting to look at. So, yeah. Yes, sorry.
What are some ways that girls not getting an education affects the Indian society?
So, think about it, about yourself, right? Like, what would happen to me if I didn't get an education? So walk through those steps in your head right now. Like, what would happen if you didn't get an education?
I wouldn't be able to get a job.
You wouldn't be able to get a job. Okay. What else?
I wouldn't be able to have a family.
Mm-hmm. After. Why couldn't you have a family after?
Because I don't have the money to support them.
Okay. You don't have the money to support them. Okay. What else? If you did have a family, what would happen to your family?
They would starve.
They would starve. You wouldn't be able to send them to school. Even if you didn't send them to school, you perhaps wouldn't be able to help them study because you wouldn't know where to start. So those are all the things that could happen with women not getting education. What do you think about that?
Some people think that it's because marriage is a special thing, so they kind of refuse to believe it.
Mm-hmm. They kind of refuse to believe that women can be raped within marriage. Okay, that's one thing. What else do you think about that?
They think the man can do whatever he wants because
Okay, a man can do whatever he wants, and a woman can't, right? Like, if a woman says, you know, I want to do this thing, then perhaps you will say, no, you can't, because you're not allowed to. Okay, that's one part of it. Another part of it is also that, you know, in marriage, a lot of marriage ceremonies, much like, you know, if you look at a Christian wedding where a father walks a daughter down the aisle and then gives her to her husband, a lot of Indian weddings are also a process of a father taking her daughter and giving her to her husband. So it's not a process of, like, you know, two equals walking together to get married. It is one person being given to another. So there's all of the, you know, all of the, like, social norms that say that you are a property of this individual that we're giving you to, this male individual that we're giving you to. And so you have to obey him. So when you say marital rape, I mean, when you legitimize marital rape, and you say that this is a thing that you can be punished for, what you're saying is that you're saying that women don't have a, I mean, you're kind of seeing them as equals in a marriage. Well, actually, the marriage ceremony in itself is built around saying that you are not equals, you are this person's property, which means that you have to follow everything that they say. Yeah, which is why marital rape is not, a lot of it is around saying that the sanctity of marriage is being eroded when you say that a woman can be raped within marriage. Does that make sense to you? Okay. Did you have a question?
Do you know the, like, the percent, like, how many of people that are raped are being raped by someone they know or a stranger? Do you know, like,
I don't actually know the percentage. But I think that more people are raped by people that they know rather than by strangers. Yeah, I think that's a percentage that is worldwide the case.
So we, like, we all know that, like, menstruation is something that is very taboo because, like, people believe it's unsanitary or
mm-hmm.
like dirty or whatever. But does in India, does this problem occur from a religion or
mm-hmm.
And like from what are the things that the religion says about menstruation?
Okay. I don't think it occurs only from religion. I think it has the same sort of reasons as it does anywhere in the world.
Yeah.
It's just a feeling of this is a gross thing that happens to you and I don't need to know about it. And a general feeling of like you have to keep this quiet. This is a part of your life that you don't talk about to other people. Religion does help it though, where you know, religion says that it's you know, it's a time of rest, it's a time where you have to be enclosed, it's a time where you have to be you know, not in public spaces, basically. There are people who read this differently though. There are a lot of women, you know, across the world and even in India who say I mean, this is not, it's not that women are being enclosed, it's not that women are being confined, it's that you are being told at a time of great physical sort of unrest where things, all kinds of things are happening in your body and you're very sensitive to pain, that you should take it easy. So you're being told not to go into the kitchen because your primary duty, you know, traditionally is to be taking care of your family and to be in the kitchen. But during the period of menstruation, it's a hard time for you, it's a time where you should rest, it's when you're sick. So you should be in bed. That's what they read it as. They read it as saying anything that says you shouldn't be outside, you shouldn't be in the kitchen, you shouldn't be touching food, is really just a way of ensuring that norms, like traditional norms, are saying that women should be allowed to take it easy when they're menstruating. That's one way to read it. A lot of other women have also read it as that's just a convenient excuse for saying that women should be kind of closed away when they're on their period.
Yeah.
It's another way of saying let's not talk about this dirty thing that happens to you.
Another form of control as
yeah.
well.
Yeah.
So you, a lot of the things that you guys are bringing up and issues you're raising, we can relate back to just issues of power and control, right?
Yeah.
What do you view, like, what do you see it as? Do you see it as something as they just want women to rest, or do you see it as more as we're kind of like putting women out of society while they're menstruating?
I mean, I think of it as a method of control, but what I think of it is not really, you know,
yeah.
important to your research project, I think. You should like think about it and see what makes most sense to you.
Mm-hmm.
And the last thing I want to say about that is also menstruating is also a sign of you turning into a woman and also a sign of now you're ready to be a mother. Which means that then, you know, across cultures, not just here, there's a lot of controlling of your sexuality, a lot of controlling who you meet, who you're spending time with. A lot of ensuring that you're not spending time with, you know, men you're not supposed to spend time with, so long, I mean, as long as you don't produce their, to ensure that you don't produce their children. So a lot of the victim blaming and slut shaming that happens ties into that as well. Saying that women should be pure, women should be virgins, women should ensure that they're not putting themselves into situations where they're fraternizing with people they shouldn't be fraternizing with. So those two things tie in together. Yes, sorry. I think that they, why do you think that they did it, actually?
I think it's because
Okay.
And I think it's because people don't understand that it's a sexual orientation and not just a feeling you get. Like, people don't just get up in the morning and be like, oh yeah, let's just be gay today.
Mm-hmm.
So,
okay.
Yeah.
So it's because people think that it's unnatural. Yeah. To answer your question. Yeah.
Do you think it's more likely for a man and a man to get a job? Like, if he has the same skills as a woman has, and if that type of
what do you think?
Well, yeah, but
why? I think you might have to like look into that. I'm not really sure if that's the case, because like India is a, you know, diverse situation where it's much like, you know, in America, where it's not just a situation of man and woman. There's also what race you are. There's also how rich you are, what kind of family you come from. There's also what kind of area you come from. So all of those things that come together to make you a more ideal candidate. So being man is one part of it. If you were a man who went to an Ivy League college, that's another part of it. If you were a man who has been to an Ivy League college and, you know, was white, that's another part of it. If you were a man that was white and went to an Ivy League college and had a long family history of, you know, money, then you were much more likely to get the job.
But if, like, they have the same background, they went to the same school, they're about the same rich kind of type, and they're like both the same, in the same country and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
The man is more likely to
get it. I'm not entirely sure. I think then you'll have to like kind of look into whether that's true or not. I think that there are various things that come into play in that kind of situation. Maybe not. I'm not really sure. Yes. What I think about prostitution in India, like, do you want to know, like, my opinion or, you know, current information on it? What do you want to know?
Like, I know it's legal in India with like a few requirements.
Mm-hmm.
And in my opinion, I think it should not be legal.
Okay.
And I know, like, the based on my research, like the clients are like politicians and police officers, and I want to know if it's related to.
Okay, so I'm not really sure what your question is on this. I don't want to give you an opinion of mine. I think that that might be a bad idea, because it really doesn't matter what my opinion is. But I think maybe you want to ask yourself why you think it shouldn't be legal. Like, what are your reasons for that? Just think about it for yourself. Because a lot of the reasons that I've heard, I've been people saying, you know, it's selling your body and that's not okay. But what if you're somebody who does construction work? What if you're somebody who, you know, is an athlete or an actor or any other work that requires you to use your body extensively? Is that not also selling your body in some respect? And is it not labor? And shouldn't we treat all labor with dignity? Maybe you should think about that, but I mean, you don't have to. You can also, like, you know, work around what your topic is. You'll find a lot of information on the internet. You just need to. There's a lot of articles that have been written about it. Very recently, Ashley Judd came to India. She's, you know, Hollywood actress. She came for this international kind of seminar thing that happened around sex work, and saying that we should ban, or we should illegalize sex work, and which caused a huge kind of disruption, because as much as they wanted to have the program, there were lots of people who said, you know, why is this person who is not involved in prostitution and sex work in any way speaking about whether we should make it legal or not? And so there were lots of debates around that. So you'll find information on the internet right now. Yeah. Yes. In what form?
Just like in society, like how some women aren't, like, you don't find a lot of women having like a good education or
mm-hmm.
getting or able to get jobs like that after.
Okay. What do you think?
Well, like, besides the fact that, you know, males are more like valuable than women,
mm-hmm.
I guess maybe. No.
Okay. So one part of it is they're more valuable than women, because perhaps if you have a male in your family, and you know, he'll always be able to provide for the family. That's one part of it. If a woman is born into the family and she gets married, she has to leave her family and she has to go, you know, either live with her husband or live with her husband and his family. So that's one part of it. Another part of it is, you know, I think everything kind of just like ties back into that, and in saying that, like, well, in the long term, they don't really work out as a viable option for the family because they're leaving the family. Another part of it is also, you know, because you want to maintain the purity of your family line, who are the people who are having the children? Women, right? So there's a lot of control that's put around women's sexuality and women's bodies in general, which means that if you want to control a woman, you ensure that, you know, she doesn't meet too many people, you ensure that she doesn't go out too much, that means that she can't get a job, that means that she may not get an education, that means that a lot of the time she's sort of confined in her house. So there's a lot of those kind of issues that come into it as well. It's a really broad question, so I'm not really sure how to answer it.
How might that look different based on just, you know, intergenerational, you know, perspectives? And I think that we're talking about, you know, a really big place. We're talking about a lot of different ways that this could look, city versus country or village, right? We're talking about, you know, so your research takes you in a lot of different directions. And I think, you know, my question might be more about, you know, the progress that you've seen in terms of gender rights and women's rights, and women's greater access to education, women's greater empowerment over themselves and their lives, and how that disrupts notions of what family might look like, or notions of, you know, when you say the woman traditionally who would be seen as leaving the family and not being able to put money back into that lineage and that line, we know that that's not true for every case, right? And that that becomes potentially less true as things change in terms of women's rights and progress and access to education. So that can disrupt some of what you're looking at too. So we have to be careful that this is not like an all-encompassing, you know, truth, right?
Yeah.
And so,
yeah.
I guess, what have you seen in terms of that, in that progress and that disruption, and how might things be changing, and what kind of insight could you give us into that, maybe?
Okay. So, I mean, that was also actually why I wanted to talk to you about all of those, like, young people and the movements that they have, which is that, just to say that, like, over history, movements have changed, and they've become about, like, really specific things. So when they talk about women and discrimination, they pick up on really specific issues, and they rally around that. So, you know, 200 years ago, there were women saying that, we shouldn't be, sati is not a thing that should happen. Do you know what sati is? Like when they say that when the husband dies, women used to be immolated with the husband. Like they used to be burned on the pyre of the husband's funeral, saying that a woman should follow her husband into the afterlife. So there were people saying that shouldn't happen. There were people saying that widows shouldn't be treated badly because, you know, they should be treated as equal citizens. Education became an issue that people rallied around. In India, we've never had to fight for voting rights because we've always had it. Or we had it once we turned into a, you know, a democratic nation. And I mean, as women got more and more freedom, one was to be, you know, treated almost equally once you got married, and, you know, once your husband was no longer with you. Then, you know, equality in education, saying women should be allowed to attend school, women should be allowed to attend college, women should, and then turned into, like, questions about, you know, jobs that women should be allowed to have. And, like, so all of those big things continue to be, you know, things that we fight for in India, but are also now, like, laws, because people fought for them so much 100 years ago. And now people are fighting for more, like, specific issues, like within an institution, like within your university, fighting for more equality on the campus, saying I should be allowed to be out for as many hours as the boys are allowed to be out in a college campus. When people, you know, say marital rape is something that we should fight for, they're saying that I should be treated as an equal citizen in my marriage. when people say, you know, female feticide is a thing that they're fighting for, there are people saying that I should be allowed to grow into an equal citizen and contribute to my family as, you know, men are allowed to contribute to my family. So a lot of the big fights have been fought already. A lot of the big, you know, laws have been made already, making women equal citizens. So it's not really the laws, like, it's not the big laws that are the problem now. It's, you know, the little things within the laws. It's the, you know, social norms. Even if laws change, a lot of norms around you and traditions don't change. So, you know, as much as people will say women have the right to work and the right to equal wage and all of those things, there will still be, you know, a lot of people who say that once they get married, they want their wives to be stay-at-home mothers. And that's a norm. That's not really a rule. It's not a law. But yeah, I mean, I suppose that's a little bit something you could talk about. Just the distinction between these two things, norms and laws and how they contribute to, I mean, how does women discrimination fit into that?
You have done a lot of talking, and you guys have asked some really great questions, and hopefully this has been helpful for you in terms of thinking about some causes of